I think ESG has come out of the shadows to a core. And if you don't believe it's core, then I don't know why many ETFs are rebranding to an ESG-focused style of investing.
So I think using an example that's very tangible, relatable to what's happening in the environment today, is a great way to educate and engage your clients on ESG investing.
That's Bob Smith, President and CIO of Sage Advisory, and Bree Williams, Head of Practice Management for State Street Global Advisors. We'd like to thank Bree and SSGA for sponsoring the live ETF Think Tank Exchange and this podcast. I'm David Dziekanski.
And I'm Dan Weiskopf. This is episode 204 of the Think Tank Exchange podcast. We're talking about why it makes sense to think about moving ESG investing towards the core of your client's portfolio. So, Dziekanski, how are you today?
Doing great, Mr. Professor. We're all getting better and better.
I remind our audience that our focus here at the Think Tank Exchange is to provide thought leadership by bridging the gap between investment producers and the advisors who use their products through actionable ideas.
Here's the current state of the environmental, social, and governance space, which we'll learn today are not all the same thing. Kicked off by our very own Kedar Wilson.
Bob, I speak to advisors on a daily basis, and they have a very much growing interest in the ESG investing space, particularly for their younger clients. I know that your firm, Sage Advisors, have a very unique model when it comes to integrating and offering ESG investment strategies to your clients. What are investors saying to you about ESG investments these days?
Well, Kedar, that's a great question. I would say they are saying that they like it a lot.
Interesting.
I think first and foremost, the number of offerings has risen dramatically. And so when there are new things out on the shelf, people come around, sniff around, they like what they see, they'll take a bite. Things like alternative technologies, in terms of energy and communications and computing and even the Zoom calls that we're having today are all an outcropping of that. And those lie at the heart of the ESG movement, in my opinion. And then you throw on top of that, the cherry on top of this cake is that the average return for ESG optimized funds last year was something close to about 28%. I'll take that every day. And so when you're looking at, getting at some of the issues of the day in the convenience of an ETF, I think it's a remarkable triple play for young investors.
I love the excitement here.
And, I would like to pose this question to both, but I'll start with you, Bree. I am a millennial. Don't hold that against me. My age group and younger, again, we show a particular interest in impact investing. Have you noticed any particular trends besides climate change that will increase, as Bob said, flows in ESG within the next decade?
I do. And it goes back again to some of the efforts in social and governance. So climate and environment is still important. But when you think of the recent developments for social justice and a push for things like greater diversity, that has resulted in a broader emphasis on racial issues. And that is particularly something we're seeing from the institutional investors. And when you think about your question of incorporating ESG into your investment strategy, since ESG portfolios incorporate all of these issues and look for companies that score well within each criteria, that has only fueled the fire of interest in ESG portfolios. If you want to get more granular on some of your questions about trends or what's really important, in all three of the pillars, I pulled the top three important items from investors of all ages, not just millennials, and it's from a global survey. So in the environmental pillar, climate change, resource management, and pollution rise to the top. In the social pillar, you have working conditions, health and safety issues, as well as impact on local communities. And then in governance, at the priority list is executive compensation, lobbying efforts, and philanthropy. But I would say, we have a lot to learn from your generation in terms of taking the action. because it's being expressed as value and values. And I think that is an important underlying motivation for us, both intrinsically and extrinsically, when we're looking to actually cast a dollar vote in the change we want to see in the world.
Yeah. I love that, the dollar vote, right? That's beautiful. Bob, I guess we'd love to hear your take on the same question.
Well, just like Bree said, that, you know, when you think about it, so what are millennials all about? And they like issues that are related to biodiversity, no GMO architecture or agriculture, rather. They are ethical governance, penal system reform. You can go on and say health and wellness, technology. They're into all kinds of the biosciences, genomics, things of that nature. So there are so many different issues that are attractive to them that have one thing in common. It really features an interest in helping community. And I think that that's where the heart of this lies, in that if we continue to focus on these kind of broad-based themes, and the other thing I would say too is that ESG has shifted. This has been a big year of changes for ESG. I think ESG has come out of the shadows of the thematic approach to investing to a core. It is now core. And if you don't believe it's core, then I don't know why every mutual fund in the world and many ETFs are rebranding to an ESG-focused style of investing. It is now a core form of investing, both on the institutional side and the private client side. And you're going to see more and more of it as we go from here.
Wow, that's excellent.
Like Venuto said, great energy there.
Yeah.
I've been an investor who follows demographic trends for my entire career. And it's been my experience that paradigm shifts caused by trends in demographics are usually powerful for the long term. Truth be told, as a baby boomer, I'm embarrassed that the millennials get all the credit for the ESG focus.
Yeah.
I was born in 1964, and regrettably, my generation never seemed to focus on investing along the lines of doing the right thing. I see this as a mistake for my demographic group. Ironically, I find that some in the prior generation, like my mother-in-law, see a great deal of value in ESG. Let's face it, many who see the world in hindsight can appreciate the mistakes of the past and can envision how the lives of the grandchildren in the future might be different.
I would argue that it might be the millennials that are pushing the move towards ESG in such force nowadays, but the adoption is really occurring across all demographics almost simultaneously right now.
Yeah, it's kind of like the grandparents are looking forward to infusing their legacy and bridging the gap and having the great conversations that they need to have with the younger generation.
Let's transition this into our next segment where Bree and Bob discussed value ESGs. Here's Bob Smith.
I think you have to first understand that mostly what I'm buying here is an index-oriented passive strategy. So what do I have to do? There are no rules as to how to define ESG optimization. So what do we have? You have some guys that are full throttle ESG and very well delineated about what they won't buy and what they are trying to progress towards what they really want to embrace in terms of ESG kind of characteristics and principles. Then you have those who are a little bit more soft on the ESG, but were very heavy on SRI negative screening. And then you have those who are really, for the most part, just Xing out tobacco, controversial weapons, nuclear power, and not much else. But they call themselves ESG optimized. So really, the devil is in the details. You need to study exactly how that construct comes together for the index. And then the most important thing is, what does that provider do in terms of concentrations within the portfolio, overweights, underweights, and what is its tracking error? How well does it track to this particular index, which I believe truly reflects what I want in my ESG portfolio? So don't buy labels. Absolutely don't buy labels, or you're going to get in trouble and you'll be left at the station thinking you had a lot of ESG when you only had a few SRI negatively screened things in your portfolio. And so I would say that you have to enter this cautiously, but enter it with your eyes wide open on the index creation.
So building on what Bob has to say, because I don't want to repeat the points, being informed as an investor is mission number one. eyes must be open, and you really have to look under the hood of what types of investment vehicles you're considering putting to work. So from the point of view of the individual investor and really helping them implement ESG into their investment portfolios, as a practitioner, you really have to understand their financial journey. So it's not just one conversation. There's no, you know, one way to do ESG investing. We have to peel back the layers of their motivations and what it is they're striving to achieve with their desired investment outcomes. So I think the common denominator among investors today is the benefits of ESG investing seem to be rather clear, but the path they should take as an individual is less than obvious. So some are just wanting to experiment, so dip that toe in the water of the ESG investing, where others are ready to make much more of a commitment and put more significant assets to work as part of their portfolio. So first and foremost, tactically, I would say education, education, education. It's critical to success and it's critical to progress. So back to the terminology, phrases like impact investing, ESG integration, very widespread, but what that actually means to that client, that individual investor, is less than clear. And that lack of clarity can get in the way and impede that progress. So giving them that solid understanding of the ESG terminology and the investment rationale go hand in hand so they can fully appreciate ESG options and benefits. You should also think about providing some examples, some portfolio examples that can be relatable and connect back to what that client's motivations are for bringing ESG investing to life. So that really is a client-centric approach, not a product approach first. What are they looking to achieve? And what then can be the suitable ESG strategies and providing that beneficial education and then giving them the long view? How do you track their progress over time so they can see that their longer term objectives are being met?
Wow, thank you for that, Bree. And just tying into that very comment you made, and a question for you is, how has State Street Global Advisors approaching and helping? How are they approaching and helping advisors from a practice management standpoint? You just spoke on how advisors can speak to clients, but how would you address the advisors from a practice management standpoint to meet their business goals when it comes to positioning ESG as a growth and engagement resource?
Sure. So I think having a framework for aiding the client conversation is helpful with ESG investing. And again, it's not a one-size-fits-all in suggesting this framework, but just a few considerations to help focus the conversation really comes down to three conversation areas. One is taking the time to review all the angles with the client or the family so you can identify what is that clear point of entry. Some question considerations would be, what are your investment objectives? In their responses here and your motivation for asking that type of question is to really determine if integrating ESG considerations fits with that individual or that family's long-term plans. Within that same area of identifying a clear entry point, you then want to understand what are your ESG priorities. And this is where you can supplement with education as part of this ongoing discovery process. So you can really clarify their motivations and help start to inform the journey, narrow their focus, which may be all the way out here when they begin asking some of these questions. And then you can help them shape their priorities. That then leads to a more natural path of, okay, let's actually look at what our market opportunities are. So you can begin now to start targeting opportunities and identifying the resources that you need to put into play. And then you can begin selecting the ESG investment strategies. Once you have that aspect of discovery down, and remember, it's not going to be static. This is going to change as their financial journey evolves over time. So that you want to keep coming back to this on this conversation of discovery so you can evolve with them as their intrinsic and extrinsic motivations continue to shape throughout their life. So you want to not let go of risk. What is that for them? How do you keep that into perspective? So you're then looking at their desired outcome priorities, which may be values-based and could be risk-based on the aspects of implementation. So you want to be looking at those as you select degrees of portfolio integration. And in terms of how much do they want to invest, you know, how much should we be allocating to ESG strategies? And in the market opportunity assessment, you can look at broader asset allocation to keep the investment plan properly allocated. You also then want to, as you always do, make sure you're not introducing sector or style biases in your portfolio construction. And then lastly, how inclusive do they want to be when you think about ESG and its application? This really can take a time to sort of step back and review their personal values within, though, their risk framework so they can understand the ESG investing considerations. And then last but not least, that helps them keep the long view. So they're not jumping in and out of an ESG solution because perhaps markets are struggling or they changed their mind because it was much more of a short-termism perspective as opposed to something with their broader financial plan in place and the overall portfolio construction. So their time horizon matters. What's their intended impact? You can then become more specific on the types of tactical opportunities and considerations of, is this a sleeve of the portfolio or even total integration? Their perspective will inform your strategies, but also help you align their expectations on the non-financial outcomes of reporting. And you can be in line with defining success, both on a personal level, as well as with the investment plan over time and their success measures as their strategies evolve and the portfolio grows.
Wow, thank you.
I love this episode because what Bree says as an answer to Kedar's great question lines up perfectly with what I always reference, structure matters. So often people think that this saying is just about portfolio construction. And in truth, this is correct. However, structure matters also in how a person and a family aligns their investment philosophies with truth.
We see perfect examples of people's perspective and philosophy of what an ESG company is change over time. We see now two oil companies move much further towards the ESG space. And at what point in their growth do they become ESG companies? And I think what we're really seeing here, as Dan mentioned, is you really have to look under the hood of the investment because the title doesn't always represent the name. There are some ETF issuers out there in the ESG space who may have six different lineups for the same product, all with completely different methodologies.
So growing up, I was told that there were two ways to spell principal, right? With an AL and with an LE. And while this may remain the case, and frankly, I'm not really a great speller, but ESG seems to solve for this definition in both ways, meaning you can get alpha, but you can also do the right thing. And that's like the intangible benefit of ESG. It always feels better if you're doing the right thing and making more money.
Well, so the success is not just based on alpha. You're not at your number one goal is not alpha versus an index. It's almost like footprint versus, that's a bad way to say it, but like a social benefit versus the index, right?
Perfect.
That's how I read it, no?
Sure. So let's talk a bit about why ESG is so right for now. Personally, I think if there is anything positive about COVID, it's that family time has become a little bit more of a focus. Life has slowed down and real conversations are taking place. This is what Venuto highlights in this next question.
So I think we've really covered here why ESG and a little bit of how ESG. In the sales process, and obviously we're not actually selling anything today, but we're educating, but there's always that question of why now? You know, we're a year into a global pandemic. We've seen a lot of things come from that have affected overall society. At the ETF Think Tank, we've written a lot about megatrends that have been accelerated in adoption because of our move to this, right? Like normally the five of us or four of us would be at a panel at some conference. Instead, we're doing this every Tuesday or Thursday, right? Bob, I want to go to you with this. What do you think has changed in terms of adoption of ESG or these types of themes in response to the COVID-19 pandemic?
We've learned to adopt and adapt in so many clever ways, and we have advanced the ball on things that we probably would have slow-footed. So maybe, yes, could be, No, we need it now. Let's go. I don't care whether it's on the biomedical side with all the virology technology, all the things that we're now recognizing, the power of genomics and so forth, and then the speed of our production facilities. All of these things, in my opinion, have given us, you know, a tremendous advance that would have taken decades.
Interesting.
And so when you look upon that, you'd say, well, the 22nd century technology has arrived at our doorstep. And now what are we thinking about? Well, I have time to think about my health and my wellness. I have time to think about social networking. I have time to think about, you know, things that I might want to do in terms of new technology I can bring into my household or into my workspace. So you sit there and say, what does this mean from an investment perspective? And like, the reality is that at the very heart of what they're all about, those themes are ESG centric. Not all of them. But I would say a great number of them. And so this idea of thematic investing in ESG has come together very dramatically. So those themes should find their ways into ESG optimized portfolios. They shouldn't be necessarily treated separate, although they can. And we have a separate thematic new frontier strategy. But this is, in my opinion, where thematic investing and ESG come together. Very comfortably. And I think that you're going to see that grow dramatically over the course of the next few years.
Bob and Bree discuss client engagement in the next session and why this is more important now than ever before. And it really starts from a standpoint of education. Right? As we mentioned before, all ESGs aren't created equal. And getting your message across and your methodology and the learning that comes with that is very important.
I know we've hit on a lot here about what ESG can do for a portfolio, potential good things to your overall mix. But beyond that, I want to move into client engagement. How does State Street talk with folks about, you know, engaging clients through the conversations of ESG?
So the first part of your question in terms of brand and reputation, absolutely, in terms of a factor with ESG, because the factors themselves of ESG are used to help the end client and help us as investors identify better managed companies. We could flag companies or business models that we are likely to see face headwinds or tailwinds. And when we look at 2020 as an example of watching companies that were not well positioned in the face of adversity, you could see them rapidly deteriorate and become a laggard, whether it was a regulatory issue, an environmental issue, a demographic challenge, or even technology challenges. Could have been on the positive side. And that brand being positioned either positively or negatively was a factor in the health of how they survived 2020 and where they're standing now as we continue the decade. So if you just focus in terms of engaging clients, if brand awareness helps them wrap their head around ESG investing and the factors, corporate governance is a great example, because good governance is not only important for the company itself, it's important for society. So corporate governance, it improves public faith and confidence in its corporate leaders. So this corporate scandals recently shed a lot of light on the effect that corporations have on social responsibility. I think that's a very tangible example for someone that's looking to educate themselves on the impact of the E, S, and G pillars and how it can help them assess the health of a company with a long view in mind. From a corporate standpoint, the leaders there, this new focus on corporate social responsibility increases their responsibility and accountability to their stakeholders. So as a result, you're watching corporations increasingly put a lot more pressure on themselves to improve their best practices for corporate governance with the goal of how can I enhance my relationships with my key stakeholders. And good governance ultimately is going to foster that sustainability. It's going to create those sustainable values. It's going to help that company achieve their values. They're recognizing that there are long-term benefits available, and that can include, how do I reduce my risks? How can I attract new investors and shareholders? And how can I increase my company's equity? So I think using an example that's very tangible, relatable to what's happening in the environment today, is a great way to educate and engage your clients on ESG investing.
That's a very good point. And let's say they're clients who may not be as open to ESG. They're looking at returns. I know, Bob, you mentioned returns. How can an advisor position ESG portfolios or ideas to a client that may be basically looking for returns or and have the idea from a branding standpoint that ESG is would not bring about the amount of returns that they get from their existing portfolio?
Sure. You know, any prospective investor or somebody who has an interest in this, you know, I always look for the place to connect with them. And, you know, generally I find nobody's against clean air or water. Everybody kind of supports fair working standards. And, you know, I think everybody wants gender equality. But, you know, the one thing that's so apolitical and really doesn't get into any of the value concerns that are confronting us every day in terms of our normal lives is this idea of governance. And I'll pick up on where Bree went to. I think that's one of the easiest non-political ways to kind of get into and examine ESG. The G component is really important because everybody thinks that they have really well-run companies in their portfolio. But what if they don't? How would they know that? And I think that's where ESG and the G component becomes very important.
Bree, what are your final thoughts here? And thank you for sponsoring the Think Tank Exchange.
Oh, our pleasure. And I think just picking up on the heart of the question for how do you address or even manage a client's expectations around performance? Because, you know, this is not just a do-good mentality. You know, it's a myth that you have to trade off performance for integration of E, S, and G. And I think intuitively, most investors would conclude that a company that has stronger E, S, and G practices would outperform the broader market over the long term. Yet many of these same investors are still holding on to that fear that if I implement ESG investing into my portfolio, I'm going to have to give up performance returns. So per some of the comments that were made earlier, and focusing the client on ESG investing, we don't believe that enhancing returns is or should be the main motivator for ESG investing. The focus really needs to be on long-term risk management. And if you do want evidence for ESG index performance, let's use the US as a proxy that saw strong, consistent performance in recent years, especially during COVID-19 related market volatility. The results were showing us that ESG integration may provide that downside risk when markets begin to struggle, only underscoring ESG's potential role as that long-term investment. So advisors and investors should work together and consider the range of risk and opportunities that can impact investment returns. And that includes these material ESG factors that Bob was referencing alongside those traditional financial factors. And I think the last word on this is yes, as an industry, we definitely have more work to do in standardizing our ESG metrics, as well as our methodologies, and most importantly, our reporting. But I think we would all agree 100% that we must not make the perfect the enemy of the good.
ESG is also a wonderful opportunity for advisors to bridge the social and generational gap between family members. Hey, I realize not every family will agree on ESG, and the younger generation may have much more stronger views than that of their grandparents or even their parents. But most would agree that those advisors who facilitate the opportunity for generations to have a deeper conversation around these issues create a bridge to the next generation who may be inheriting wealth that so many advisors are currently protecting.
And sometimes that goes even further, not just to where you're investing, but what you do with your company profits. And we're very happy to wrap up our program, as always, discussing our guest, Bob Smith's charity of choice here.
Sure. Thank you for the opportunity. And ladies and gentlemen, this is a great way to have impact. And if that's what you're keyed in on, I've got a real good one for you. CharityWater.org was an organization started by Scott Harrison back in 2007. He wrote a New York Times bestseller called Thirst. And the book itself is about his reawakening from a life of not dedication to a life of pure dedication to purpose, and very inspirational. But in today's world, 785 million people live without clean water. That's one in 10 people on this planet, or two times the size of the United States population, do not have access to clean water. Clean water is, in fact, killing more people annually than all forms of violence and war combined. And of those people that are killed annually, 43% of them are children under the age of 5. And so Scott saw this. Scott made it his life's work in about 2000 and formed this organization. And it's a really great story. And if you have an opportunity to go onto his website and see him tell his story, you come away with a feeling like, I got to do something. I have to participate. In his time since he started this, he has launched 59,000 individual water projects around the world that have served over 11.5 million people that never had it before. In 2019, he raised $56 million. Since he started this thing, he's raised $500 million for this crusade. He's got the platinum seal of approval from GuideStar. He's an A-rated charity on Charity Watch. And all I ask you to do is give it a look. Join the spring, become a member, and watch impact happen.
That's beautiful.
Well, as we wrap up this episode, we'd like to thank Bree Williams and State Street Global Advisors for sponsoring this podcast and the live show. And of course, we thank Bob Smith with Sage Advisors for his thoughts.
You can learn more about the ETF Think Tank and the Think Tank Exchange by visiting etfthinktank.com, your source for ETF ideas, thought leadership, strategies, tools, and growth tactics.
That's because our value proposition is to enhance yours. I'm Dan Weiskopf.
And I'm David Dziekanski. Keep the exchange going with your clients. Until next time, take care.
The views and opinions expressed during this event are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of the sponsor or organizer. Information set forth during this event has been obtained or derived from sources believed by the participants to be reliable. However, neither the sponsor nor the organizer make any representation or warranty, express or implied, as to the information's accuracy or completeness. Nor does the sponsor organizer recommend that the information shared during this event serve as the basis of any investment decision, and it has been provided to you solely for informational purposes only, and does not constitute an offer or solicitation of an offer or any advice or recommendation to purchase any securities other than financial instruments, and may not be construed as such.